How would it feel to lose 40 pounds? Even when you're over 40, you are a smart woman. You know you need to move more and eat less, but why don't you do it? Or maybe you think you are doing all the things and still not seeing the results you want. If this is the case, you are in the right place. Welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. I'm your host, Nicole Simonin, and I help women over 40 lose weight for the last time. This podcast will teach you all about fitness, nutrition, and most importantly, your mindset. Plus, we have some special guests stop by to share their stories. Now on to today's show. Hey everybody, welcome to the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. I have a great special guest today. So Rose is a keynote speaker, coach, and Amazon best-selling author who helps busy people reduce stress, improve wellness, and create more work-life balance through simplicity. If you want to know how many towels she owns, you can watch her 2018 TEDx talk, which has over 400,000 views. And one, because I watched it today. And Rose's advice has been featured on usatoday.com, and she's been a guest on Good Day Columbus, WYSOWVXU, Good Morning Cincinnati, and Living Dayton. I don't know why I said Dayton.
It's all right. It sounds more fancy when you say Dayton.
I know.
I think that's how they should say from now on.
So welcome, Rose, to the podcast. I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you, Nicole. I'm so happy to be here.
Awesome. So tell the listeners a little bit about your story and how you got started in your business.
Sure. So my story is a very much a personal story. I have three children. They are triplets. They're 10 years old now. But when they were about two, I was a full-time working mom. I was teaching middle school at the time. So I'm doing the like double shift, right? Where you're working the job that pays you, you're coming home to the unpaid job of parenting. And it was just very exhausting. And what I found was at the end of the day, when I finally got my kids in bed, if I was lucky, I had maybe 1 hour to myself before I had to get myself to bed and get up the next day and do it all over again. And all I wanted to do during my remaining precious hour of the day was just relax, refresh, sit down on my couch, have, you know, a book, a mug of tea, a glass of wine, whatever. But I found that instead of doing that, I was serving my stuff for the last hour or two of my day. I was picking up toys and shoes and sippy cups and moving piles of paper around, and it was exhausting. And I felt like I never had any time to myself. And I remember talking to a friend about this at the time. It was actually right after Christmas was kind of the tipping point when we'd been blessed with all these wonderful gifts from loving grandparents and friends. And I just thought, oh my gosh, this is so overwhelming. I don't have room for the stuff that we currently own. We lived and still live, by the way, in a home that's just over 1500 square feet. So it's not a big home by American standards. So I'm like, we don't have enough space for the stuff we own, getting all this new stuff. I'm just so overwhelmed. I think I'm just going to buy a bigger house because I thought that was the answer to my problem. And my friend looked at me and she said, or you could just become a minimalist. And I had never really heard that term outside the realm of artwork. I didn't really understand what it meant, but I went home and I started reading about it and it absolutely clicked with me. And I realized that the answer to my problem was not reorganizing the stuff or buying a bigger house to contain my stuff. The answer was to simplify, minimize, reduce the amount of stuff that I had. And then my life just got so much easier. So I went on this about 8 month big purge of everything in my house. I let go of about, I would estimate about 70% of what we owned in that 8 month period. And it was just so freeing. I started to find myself able to have more of that downtime, that relaxing time at the end of the day than I'd had before. And so that was what I was really experiencing. It wasn't really so much a physical change, which is I know what you talk about as well. It's not so much the physical change in your body or the physical change in your home, but the mental and emotional change that you feel more satisfied, you feel more at peace. And so I started a blog about simplicity and people started reading it and I started getting some requests for help from other people. You know, could you come to my house and help me do this? And I thought, well, that would be really fun. But at the time I was working a full-time job and had three toddlers and I was like, yeah. Have time to go to your house and help you clean your closet. Sorry. But I eventually around two, the year 2015, I took a leap of faith and I left my classroom teaching job. I started my business that year, coaching people one-on-one. And that has grown over the years from helping people one-on-one in their homes to now I do everything virtually. I have online courses. I have a membership program that's online. I do coaching online. And as you had mentioned, a lot of public speaking around the idea of simplicity, because I think what it really brings is that sense of balance in our lives that we're often missing when we feel like we're overwhelmed or drowning in physical stuff. So that's my story.
Yeah. Well, first of all, when I listened to your TEDx, I almost fell on the floor when you said you had triplets. I was like, what?
Believe me, I did too when I found out I was going to have triplets.
I'm sure. Same
reaction.
Yeah. Because, you know, I mean, some people have twins and that's, you know, that's still like, I can't imagine. My kids are 22 months apart. So it's close, but it's not, you know, but I could not imagine having three. I guess it has its advantages and disadvantages. Like they all go through the same thing at once. They all, you know, the diapers get, you know, through very quickly and that kind of thing. But when I heard that and then knowing what you talk about, I was like, wow, that must have been very challenging, because not just the fact that there are three of them, but then there's times three stuff and things that they have. And yeah. So when you were doing your purge, did you sell most of your items or did you donate, or how did you?
I donated the vast majority, because like I said, I was a full-time working mom. I had 3 2-year-olds. I didn't have time to post things for sale. And most of the things that I was letting go of were not worth the time it would have spent me to try to sell them. So I just would take huge carloads to Goodwill. I had a friend who was raising money at the time to go on a missions trip to Africa, and she was doing a big yard sale. So every weekend I would just bring her tons of stuff that she could sell to fund her trip. And yeah, my goal was freedom. I wanted the freedom from the stuff more than I wanted any money for the stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I could have sold it. I could have taken the time, and it's thousands of dollars worth of stuff. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But that's not what I wanted. I didn't want the thousands of dollars. And again, I'm not like super fancy, so it wouldn't have been like $10,000.
Right. No Gucci. Maybe like,
maybe like $2,000, $1,000. I don't even know.
Yeah.
But what I wanted more than anything was the freedom, and the quickest route to the freedom was to just give it away and know that I was blessing people with that stuff and they could use it. And that was enough goodness for me. So yeah, it was tons of donation runs.
When I had my son first, there was a point where I had too many baby clothes and I wasn't working at the time. And I was like, oh, I'll sell them on eBay. That was like a full-time job in itself. And what the end of the story was, is the lady wanted to buy like pretty much everything. I just threw everything and anything in this big, huge box and sent it to her. And I know she paid like, I don't know, $10. And I think I paid more in shipping to get it to her. And I was like, I don't care.
Yeah.
Get it out. Yeah.
Yeah. I often tell people if they're planning to sell stuff, you really want to break it down to what your hourly wage would be for selling those things. Like even if you do a garage sale and you make $300 or $400 at the garage sale, how much time did you spend setting everything out? How much time did you spend sitting there? How much time did you spend packing it all back up, the things that didn't sell? Mm. How much time did you spend advertising? You know, when you actually break it down, for most of the things people want to sell, it's not worth the time that it takes to sell it. Now, if it's a car, if it's really nice jewelry, like I will sell a car, like an act, you know, on eBay or Craigslist, but I'm not going, you know, clothes, baby clothes are a really good example that you're just not going to get.
Let them go.
Let them go. Let it go. Just like Elsa.
Yeah, right. So talk a little bit about how clutter relates to stress.
So there's a pretty clear link between clutter and stress. And I think most of us inherently know this. If we're in a cluttered environment, we feel a little more on edge. We feel a little more stressed. If our email looks really crazy or we walk into our bedroom and it's a disaster, we feel that. And that's also proved by science. So the Princeton University Neuroscience Institute did a study And it was very scientific, of course, because they're very smart. But the bottom line was that clutter distracts us and it inhibits our ability to focus on things. So when we are in a cluttered environment, we actually can't do our most productive, effective work, whatever that is, whether that's your work at your actual job, whether that's creating a healthy meal for your family, whether that's doing exercise or taking clear steps towards your goals. Mm-hmm. If you're in a cluttered environment, it adds distraction to your life, which adds stress. Another study that I really like to tell people about is this study that UCLA did several years ago, and they followed 32 different families. They were dual income working families. They followed the families for about 4 years. And one of the things they found was that specifically for the mothers in the family, the working mothers, if they described their home as messy or chaotic, they had an increased level of cortisol in their saliva. So there was a measurable actual scientific notice of the stress response to perceiving the home as cluttered or chaotic. Now, interestingly, this is entirely dependent on how you view your home. So they also tested the fathers or spouses in these families, and they often didn't have the same perception of the space as being cluttered or chaotic. Thus, they didn't have the stress response that the wives had. And I've worked with way more than 32 families and students in my career, and I can tell you with certainty, I don't have scientific studies to prove this, but from my own experience, clutter in the home doesn't just affect women. I think we often think that it does, but it affects men, it affects children, it affects grandparents, it affects people who might babysit for you, people who might work in your home doing house cleaning or whatever you have people do for you. If there is clutter and chaos in your home, it's actually affecting anybody and everybody who's in that home. Mm-hmm. And maybe some people are just affected more than others. So there is a very clear link. And so one of the things that I found in my own life and by working with so many clients and students over the years is the number one thing that people say to me when they're done with my course or we're done with coaching or in the coaching process is, I feel so much better. They don't say it looks so much better. They might think it looks better, but what they say is, I feel so much better. And that was my experience too. I felt better. And that's why I kept going, doing what I was doing, because I couldn't get enough of this feeling of freedom.
I know when clients come to me and the people that I train online, I always tell them to try to have a separate room where they have their weights or whatever their workout they're going to do. Because what happens is if you are working out in your living room or family room or whatever you want to call it, and you're seeing toys and clutter, you don't want to do that workout. You're going to immediately go and be like, I have to clean these things. Or if you see the dishes in the sink, that kind of thing. So yeah, I totally understand on that part. Okay, so tell a little bit about how clutter relates to your weight and how you can lose weight by decluttering.
Yeah, so just like the link between clutter and stress, if you see that link, which I think people do see and they feel, it's not a hard jump to see the link then between clutter and weight, because as you talk about on your podcast and many people talk about, and there's plenty of research to show, stress contributes to weight gain. Mm-hmm. And so there have been some studies that have been done on this. The Boston Globe published in 2008 a study that showed a group of people who self-reported that they had problems with clutter. They struggled with clutter. And they found that that group of people were 77% more likely to be overweight or obese. So if we're struggling in one area of our lives with excess, whether that's excess weight, excess responsibilities, excess stuff, we're probably struggling in other areas of our lives. So if we have excess clutter, we may also be carrying excess weight. And that idea of stress as well, we also know that when we are under stress or we're in a cluttered environment, we're more likely to do some of those avoidance strategies that you had talked about, right? If I'm feeling stressed or overwhelmed by my stuff, I might just be more likely to go to the fridge for some junk food. I might be willing to just like scroll through my social media and be sedentary longer. I'm going to distract myself to avoid dealing with that thing. And clutter is one of those things that can cause us to go into distraction techniques, which again is going to lead to weight gain. And so one of the things, and I can just share some personal stories from people I've worked with where I've seen this happen. I had a woman that I worked with. She was one of my members of a challenge group that I did. And the challenge was a 12-day challenge to let go of one item the first day, two items the second day, so on and so forth. By day 12, you've let go of like 80 some items.
Oh, wow.
It was just a fun little challenge. And she joined the group. And most people in the group are, you know, letting go of, oh, I got rid of some coffee mugs and my shoes and these extra sweaters and all this stuff. And it's great. And she said, I think what I'm going to do is go through my deceased husband's belongings in the attic. Uh-huh. And I thought, oh boy, okay. When we talk about emotional stuff.
Right.
That's right. The most emotional stuff, stuff that is left from someone we loved who's passed on. There's all sorts of grief and sadness packed into those boxes. And here she's going to tackle this really difficult thing, which I never recommend people starting with that stuff, but that's where she's going to start. And I was like, okay, sent her a message. I said, if you need support, reach out. Here's my phone number. And amazingly, she dealt with it. She got through the things and saved the things she wanted to save. And he'd been gone for 10 years. She saved the things she wanted. And then, because I know her, I actually, my kids are in school with her kids. So he passed away of ALS when her daughters were babies. So I know her. And I would see her and I'm like, I'll call her Erica. I said, Erica, you just look amazing. She's like, yeah, I've lost 20 pounds. So she started this decluttering process. It resulted in her then taking some health measures, some positive steps toward better health. She went back to school to get some extra training. And it was like she told me, and I did an interview with her because I was just so amazed at this transformation, that letting go of those things was like letting go of her definition of herself as a widow.
Yeah.
And when she let go of that, she was able to open up to a new life, which included weight loss. It included also getting out of a bad relationship that she was in. It included, you know, going for a new career. It was all of these amazing transformations. But the thing that started that ball rolling was decluttering and letting go of excess things. So that's just one example of how this can happen. And on top of that, at a very practical level, decluttering is physical activity.
Right.
I mean, let's be honest here. Like, if you have ever decluttered your garage, your closet, you're tired after doing that because you're going up and downstairs. You've got your arms above your head. You're squatting. You're lifting. You're bending. Once, when I used to do in-home professional organizing, I wore a Fitbit. I don't usually wear one because I don't like counting my steps for some reason. But I wore one because it was a challenge I was doing. And I think I had, 8,000 steps in one session with a client, just because you're not sedentary when you're decluttering. So at a practical level, the act of decluttering itself could be considered a workout.
Yeah. I think a lot of people think when they have to work out, like it has to be structured weight training. It has to be, I have to go run. I have to step on a cardio piece of equipment or something like that. And you know, you can definitely get a great workout doing laundry, vacuuming, you know, even normal chores. But definitely decluttering. I guess it depends on how much clutter you have will determine how hard your workout will be, for sure, when you are decluttering. Yeah. One of the things you had said about like cortisol levels raising, I mean, that is definitely, you know, we always go from fight or flight mode, and you know, definitely, like you said, especially with everything, we're kind of being let out at the date of this recording. You know, COVID is still going on. Just the cortisol levels and people seeing the stuff and raising the cortisol levels and then reaching for things because they want that buffer. We call it a buffer, and just kind of putting the blinders on and kind of being like, I don't want to deal with that, so I'm going to overeat. But yeah, I do find that there's definitely a correlation between overconsumption, too much spending or your finances, and clutter. I mean, it's amazing how they all kind of, you know, when we do one thing in life, we seem to do it the same thing in all areas, which is very interesting.
Yeah, it shows up everywhere, right? The excess shows up everywhere, right? In our closets, in our weight, in our finances, like you said, in our relationships, in our work, if we have excess in our schedules, it's the same process. And that's been the interesting thing for me as I've gone through this process. Like I said, it took me 8 months to let go of about 70% of my physical stuff, but that wasn't the end of my journey. That was just the beginning of the journey, because as I went on with that mental clarity that I opened up from decluttering physical stuff, I realized I needed to declutter my career. I was not meant to be in that teaching career anymore. I needed to do this work that I'm called to do now. And then after I started my business and I was doing that, then there was this call, this pull to dig into my finances and declutter that. Because you know what? I was in my mid-30s and I'd never kept a budget. I had no idea how to do that. And so I researched and I taught myself and I learned how to take control of my finances and pay off. We paid off like six figures of debt in just over 2 years. And I know now that's a result of me decluttering some towels and starting the process of being willing to face the messy situation I was in and take action on it.
Right.
And it's just, it shows up in health as well. So one of the things that I've noticed within the last year, it's like this simplicity journey keeps going. I have cut out pretty much all processed meat, most meat, alcohol, a significant amount of sugar. And I see that now I'm like, this is the same pattern. It's repeating itself again. There's excess in my life. I need to look at it and face it for what it is and let go of what's not serving me. And that, it's just amazing that it happens over and over and over again. And I'm never done with it. I'm like, there's always more to let go, right?
Right. It's like, you feel like you've accomplished one lesson and then one rolls right back in. It's a constant circle. So I think too, when we accept that we are responsible for what's going on, I think that's a big key. I know I stress that with my clients is you have to be responsible for your actions and what you're doing. And if, you know, if you want to lose weight, you have to take responsibility for that. And same thing, if you have clutter, you need to take responsibility for that. So with that said, how do you get your spouse on board or your partner, whoever else is living in the chaos with you?
Yeah, that is a wonderful question. That's a question that I get a lot. And so my first answer to that is you deal with your own stuff first. Because a lot of times, like you said, you have to face your responsibility, right? So often when I talk to people about their clutter or their situation, they immediately want to start blaming the spouse, the kids, the brother-in-law who lives in the basement, the mother-in-law who always buys the kids stuff. Mm-hmm. But you know what? You don't have control over any of them. Even if they're your children, you do not have control over them and their thought processes, right? And their decision-making. Right. The only person you have control over is you. So you start with your own stuff. You know, Gandhi said, be the change you wish to see in the world. I will say, be the change you wish to see in your house. If you desire a more neat and tidy living environment, look at the things that you have absolute jurisdiction over in that environment and get those in order. I often tell people start in the bathroom because that's typically a place where there isn't much emotional connection, unlike my friend who started with the deceased husband's belongings. That's like, oh, don't start there. Start in the bathroom because you're probably not that attached to your mascara and lipstick and beauty products.
Toothbrush, yeah.
Right. You're probably not. I don't know. Maybe you are. And then you work your way up to harder stuff. But the all other good thing about starting in the bathroom is that's probably your stuff. You have control over your beauty products. You have control over your lotions. And then maybe move on to something else you control, like your clothing, your collection of books, your stuff. And what happens, and I've seen it happen every single time, so I can attest to this with absolute certainty, it's like a little ripple effect, and the people you live with will start to take notice. They will start to take notice. And then once they start to take notice, you can invite them in to help you. Like, hey, I was wondering if you could help me go through the toys in the toy room. You can invite your kids in and they might say no. And that's okay, right? You just invited them in. They can say no. But what it also means if they opt out is they've also given up their voice in the decision making of some of those things, right?
Interesting. My philosophy is that I'm going to wait for 6 years till they're gone out of the house and then do a big purge.
That's another way to do it. But here's what I tell parents, especially, is you would be surprised at how good your kids can be at letting go if they're given the chance to learn. So I know for me, I was never taught how to let go. As a kid, my mom was raised by a mom who lived through the Great Depression, taught to save everything, reuse. And those are good lessons, but it doesn't always translate to our current society. Yeah. So I tell parents, you know, the first time you introduce broccoli to your kid, they probably didn't want to eat it. And maybe the second, third, fourth, 12th, 13th, 18th time, they may not have wanted to eat it, but they're being exposed to that lesson. Eventually they may try it and then they're willing to learn. So I think when we struggle and think like, oh, our spouse wouldn't do this or our kids won't do this, well, have they been given an open opportunity to get on board, right? And if you've set the example, then you can invite them in. And you're also not coming from a place of hypocrisy, right? Because if we're trying to get them to clean up their stuff, but we haven't cleaned up ours, that's not going to get us anywhere. So be the change first. That may naturally just spread out. And if it doesn't, then you can actually take some measures, invite them in, ask if they would like your help. And also realize I'm not advocating that everyone in your home should be able to put their stuff everywhere. Because one of the things I say is if you're living with people, there's an expectation that everyone's space is respected, right? So my husband has tubs of baseball cards and Star Wars toys in the attic. And I certainly wouldn't have those, but he does. About once a year, I ask if he wants to go through them. He says no. I say, okay.
Yeah.
But they're not in my way of living the life I need to live on a daily basis. Now, if those tubs were on my dining room table where I need to eat dinner and work, well, then we have to have a more serious conversation about it because it's actually impeding me from living my life the way I need to.
Yeah.
So those are some of the things that I tell people when they ask about getting the spouse or the kids on board. Set the stage and then invite them in, and you will be surprised that they will get on board with you usually.
So I have a, what I find amusing story to share.
Yeah.
When my kids were little, so remember I told you they're 22 months apart. I have a son and I have my daughter, and total opposite personalities.
Yeah.
They were very little. And I was like, ooh, I want you guys to pick out 10 toys that you don't want anymore. And we're going to donate them to charity. And I said, put them outside of your rooms. Well, my son went and got 10 things and he put it outside of his room. And then my daughter went and got 9 things of my son's and one of hers and put it outside of her room.
She's smart. I like the way she thinks. As a clever child.
Yeah. And then the horrible part of the story was that later on that night, my son woke up in the middle of the night screaming at the top of his lungs, "I don't want to donate. I don't want to donate." I mean, like he was having a nightmare. And I was like, oh my gosh, I have just traumatized my children for life. But we do donate. But and he has gotten over that. My daughter, not so much. But but it was such a, you know, it's funny looking back. At the time, I was like, oh my gosh, what have I done to these kids?
Right.
But it's interesting how their perspective of what they value and what is important to them at that time. And I know as an adult now, I look back and I know I had tons of stuffed animals and stuff at one point. And then there was like one day and I was like, gone. You know, I put them all in a bag and I donated them. So I think there's a season for things that we have too as well. And just, you know, kind of like the lady who was holding on to her husband's thing. It was time for her to move on and let them go.
And I always say people know when they're ready to let go. I mean, your kids know when they're ready to let go. You know when you're ready to let go. And a lot of times people say, well, my kids, they'll call their kids hoarders. My kids would never let go of this. And I always think, well, there are certain things that your kids want to keep for them, just like there are certain weird things we as adults want to keep, like that broken coffee mug that we got on vacation 10 years ago. There's something about it that we are holding on to. And if someone tried to force us to get rid of that, we would rebel, we would cling, we would hold on to it. Your kids have those same reactions and those same feelings. So there's their things. There's things they're ready to move on from and things they're not. And that's how you are. That's how we all are. And as long as we approach it from a respectful standpoint, respecting their feelings, it really can go very, very smoothly.
Yeah. 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 I wish there was a happier ending to that little story. No, let's leave it at that.
It's totally fine. I'm sure that he, and again, that was probably, was that the first time that you'd ask them to donate something?
I think it was. And they were little. They were like, I mean, my daughter was probably 2 or 3, so he would have been 4 or 5.
Yeah, I generally tell parents much under the age of 5, kids just really developmentally, they're so egocentric. Mm-hmm. They haven't developed the capacity to understand how letting go of something could help someone else. That's just right. Not a thing they can actually think yet. So if they're under the age of 5, I totally support just decluttering for them while they're asleep, because they also probably won't remember.
Right.
But once they hit that school age of like 5 or 6, that's when I encourage people to start introducing the idea and introducing the practice. So part of it could have been they were just a wee bit young,
yeah,
maybe, and I think they're going to be fine.
I'm sure they will.
I have a feeling they won't relive this in therapy, but I don't know.
I know. I'm saving money for that. So, Rose, you have a free Simplicity Starter Guide that people can get a customized checklist, right, to declutter their entire house. And you can find that at roselounsbury.com/start here. We will have all the show notes at shapeitupfitness.com. Everything you want to know about Rose, her TED Talk, her links will all be there. So you can also go there. Can you tell everybody where to find you?
Certainly. So the best place to find me is my website, which is roselounsbury.com. That's roselounsbury.com. And I'm also on Instagram at Rose Lounsbury and Facebook at Rose Lounsbury and LinkedIn.
Awesome. All right. So let's dive into the speed round. Are you ready?
I'm ready. I'm really excited about the speed round. Okay. I don't know the questions ahead of time, so it's going to be totally off the top of my head.
She does not know the questions at all. Calculus question number one coming at you. No, I'm just kidding. All right. So number one, what is your favorite vacation that you have been on?
Redong Island in Malaysia.
Nice. When did you go there?
In college, I studied abroad in Malaysia, and some of my friends and I went there. It's the most beautiful place I've ever been.
Oh, wow. Do you have plans on going back?
I would love to. The only problem is it takes literally 2 days to fly there.
Oh.
So, you know, it's harder with my adult life than when I was free and
single and didn't have triplets.
Didn't have triplets. Yeah, those triplets, they're the ones holding me back.
All right. Number two, what is your favorite book?
To Kill a Mockingbird.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Classic.
It's a classic. It's so good though.
And what is your favorite time of year?
Summer, because it's my birthday.
Oh, when's your birthday?
June 23rd.
It's coming up.
I know.
Awesome. Yeah. Are you going to celebrate big? Or are you still in COVID?
In coronavirus, big could be kind of relative. I think I will have my husband cook me dinner and make me his famous chocolate cake.
Nice.
And then who knows? From there, anything goes. Could get real crazy after that.
COVID party of one. Yeah. All right. What is your favorite movie?
Favorite movie. Okay. One of my favorite movies is, there's a series of movies. It's called Before Sunrise. And then 10 years later, they made a movie called Before Sunset. And then they made a third one, but it follows the same actors where they meet. And it's kind of like in real time. It shows like their relationship developing. And then 10 years later, the same actors show how the relationship has developed 10 years later. And then they did another one 10 years later with the same actors. It's Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy. And they're such great romantic movies, kind of like indie type movies, but those would be some of my favorite movies, the three of them. But start with the first one. Start with Before Sunrise.
Oh,
it's a good one to watch with somebody that you love.
That's a pretty neat idea.
Yeah.
And a little daring, because you're talking a 30-year span, 40 almost year span.
Yeah, I mean, it shows, you know, that young love, the first meeting, you know, you're like 20-something, and then 10 years later when you're in your 30s, what does that look like?
Yeah.
Right? 10 years later in your 40s, what does that look like? And it's kind of showing like stages of a relationship. And each movie, it is just interesting because if the time that elapses in the movie is 24 hours, that's what you see. You're not seeing, you know, big swatches of time go by, and a lot of the movie is just them talking to each other. as they go through the day together.
Oh, that's so cool. I'll definitely have to check that out. All right, the last question. What is your favorite inspirational quote?
My favorite inspirational quote. That is a tough one because I do love a lot of quotes. You know, this is one that I don't know if I heard it from someone else or I came up with it, so I can't attribute it to anyone. But I often think of this as every moment is another chance. So no matter what's going on, no matter what you've said that was dumb or what you did that you wish you didn't do or whatever you ate that you wish you didn't eat or whatever you bought that you wish you didn't buy or whatever, every moment is another chance.
Yeah.
It's another way of saying that the only power we have is in the present. So it's a way of like letting go of whatever's come before and say, this moment is a new chance for me to do better. And there have been many times in my life where that phrase has helped me just sort of like take back my power in the moment and let go of whatever I was replaying in my mind or fretting over. And it's a continually, one I continually remind myself of because I forget it. I forget that every moment is another chance. Every moment is new. So that would be my favorite quote.
No, I like that a lot. I always tell people, like, you always have a choice. You always can decide, you know, whether you want to eat the donut or whether you don't want to eat the donut, that kind of thing. And it doesn't matter what you choose because that's your choice, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I love that.
Recognizing that you have the choice and owning the choice that you make, because I think a lot of times we go through life feeling like life is happening to us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very powerless way to feel. That's like coming at life from like a victim circumstance, a victim perspective.
Absolutely.
And so, yeah, I love that. You always have a choice. It just like flips it and says, no, I have a choice. Even if my choice is just what I think, which is actually the most important place to make a choice.
Right.
I always have a choice in what I think. No one else, even if you physically were restraining me, you can't change what I'm thinking. I have a choice about my thoughts.
Yeah, I love that. That was actually one of the like pivotal moments in my life where I realized that like I get to think whatever I want and no one can, you know, affect that any way, shape or form. And it's like you're saying, it's very powerful, especially when you're coming from that place and you do make a choice. Do you know? And it's one thing to feel like things are happening to you, but yet you get to control what you do with that. I mean, COVID is a perfect example. You know, it's a horrible situation, but you get to choose whether how you want to think about it, what you want to do, that kind of thing. And knowing that you always have another option or other options is always more freeing than feeling like exactly what you're saying, like victim mentality and feeling powerless. So to wrap everything up, do you have like one gem of piece of advice that you can give people on decluttering?
Yes, this is my number one piece of advice, and it is to start a constant donation box. Mm-hmm. If you do not have a constant donation box in your house, just get a literal box from Amazon, or maybe just like a plastic tub you're not using, or an old laundry basket you're not using. It doesn't matter. It needs to be a receptacle. And just put it somewhere, and every time you come across something in your home that you don't need, that you're not using, put it in the box. And if you want to get real serious about this, you could put one of those boxes on every level of your home. You could put one in your kids' rooms and one in your room. But what it does is it makes decluttering a habit, a daily habit, as opposed to the once a year, you know, burn and purge through the whole house. And when your box is full, you just bag up what's in there, put it in the front seat of your car, drop it off on your next time that you're out, your favorite charity, then start filling the box up again. So that one little habit, even if that was all that you did, would start to chip away at the excess in your home. And you would be amazed at how quickly you'll start to see results from that.
Well, I'm glad you gave that as your tip because I have been doing that. My problem is Goodwill is not open. So now I've got piles of stuff.
Yes.
And I'm trying to make sure it doesn't get mixed back in.
Yes, you need to start a donation central in your house where everything is in bags that you can't see through.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, there's the donation center. And as soon as the donation centers are open again,
we're going to
just take it all with
you. Yes, that is what I'm hoping for.
They will be open soon. They're open here in Dayton now.
Oh, are they? Yeah, I'm in South Jersey. So they are just, I think, I don't I don't know if donation centers are actually opening, but we're just starting to kind of open things up. So I'll be curious to see what happens as time goes on. All right, Rose, thank you so much for being here. I think you gave a lot of valuable tips to everyone. And again, everybody can go to the show notes at shapeitupfitness.com and get everything about Rose. And you can also visit Rose at her website. You want to give your website one more time, Rose?
Absolutely. My website is roselounsbury.com. That's roselounsbury.com.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being on, Rose, and definitely go check her out. And I think that's a wrap for today. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Nicole.
Hey, if you're loving this podcast, I want to hear from you. Head over to the Apple Podcast and scroll all the way down at the bottom of the Shape It Up Over 40 podcast. Please write a review. I can't wait to see what you write. Once you're done with your review, head over to shapeitupfitness.com and find out how you can get started on losing the weight for the last time.